silent scripture in committee. Do you have any apologies for absence?
We do, Chair. We've got apologies from Councillor Brian Kenny, apologies from Councillor Warren Ward, Councillor Andrew Hodgson, and Councillor Tracy Pilgrim.
Chair, can I just say I'm deputising for Brian Kenny?
And I'm deputising for Warren Ward.
Thank you, Anita. Okay. Can I ask for members to put any declarations of interest and to confirm that there's no party?
Chair, declaration of interest in item number four. I believe it's four. So the report is Libraries, Leisure, Culture, Parks and Transformation Workshop. Due to committee deadlines, the reports have not been included in the public agenda pack, but were circulated to members prior to committee. Members will be aware of the review of the Council's Library, Leisure, Culture, Parks Services as part of the Council Transformation Programme. A workshop was arranged for Monday the 11th of September for members of this committee to scrutinise in more detail the proposals to transform these services. A report from this session was circulated to two members prior to committee, and members are invited to comment on the contents of this report. As Chair, I would like to express my disappointment regarding the poor attendance at this session. All members were invited to attend, yet only five did. For such few members to engage with the scrutiny of an important and wide-ranging aspect of this Council's provision is disappointing. It is especially disappointing as members will recall the calling of a Cabinet decision to approve further progress on this transformation project as recently as June this year. I hope for much improved attendance at any future scrutiny sessions. I will now go to Mark Smith to give us an update with regards to that question.
Yeah, thank you, Chair. Just in terms of context then, so we've obviously got a very important project ongoing at the moment around libraries, leisure, parks and cultural services. The key purpose of the workshop was essentially for members to spend time looking at the evaluation process, which is one of the most important aspects of the project. Essentially, the evaluation process is what is used to evaluate the various potential delivery models. You know, for example, whether this is an enhanced in-house direct delivery model or whether it might be an alternative delivery model such as a charitable trust or community interest company. So that was the key purpose of the session. We managed to make a certain amount of progress in the session, so I'd like to thank the members that came along for the feedback that we did get. We actually had some really useful suggestions and ideas. One of the key themes that came through is something as officers were looking at, is that this was about looking at the criteria and the weightings that would be considered to assess the models against, as I say. And members were of the view that based on the scale of the portfolio of services and the diverse nature of them, officers were asked to go away and look at how we might be able to look at the individual service areas such as parks or leisure or libraries, because they do have some very distinct characteristics. And members were of the view that there might be different scores and weightings and criteria for the various bits of the service. So we've had some really good quality feedback that we've taken away, but obviously, Chair, as you're suggesting, a further session on this would be very, very helpful in terms of taking the project forward. And just a final point in terms of the latest timeline. So we have now got some more time to do that. The original plan had been to take the full business case to Cabinet in October, and because of primarily the amount of quality feedback that we've had from the engagement exercise, and based on the scale and the complexity of the project, what we're now looking to do is to take an update to Cabinet in November around those issues and the progress on the project so far, and then just set out the key steps and the timetable going forward. So, as you suggested, Chair, one of the benefits of that revised time frame is that it does give us a bit more time, it gives members a bit more time to spend time scrutinising the project. Thank you.
Okay, thank you, Mark. Is there any comments from members? Stina?
Sorry, Mark, I have to go back to page 4. The 4 paragraph down, where you have included what I said about the golf course as an example. And I'm using an example, and my example was quite clear, but I'm still not sure whether you've got it or any of you got it. If we are comparing and we're doing the measuring and all the other things, which I think we all accepted, that's what we were there to do. If we know something is not being run correctly, not because the rules say it's not being run, not because the staff aren't doing their job, but because the officers have never enforced the rules, how can we make those sort of distinctions? And that's the point I'm making. How can we compare? We don't know. I know in this individual case, but that could be mirrored across the world. And therefore, we're going to be making decisions about something which may well be because people have decided it's easier to ignore a problem, like collecting money for people who play golf. Is my example. It's not my whole life and being. It is an example. Why? How are we supposed to make these distinctions? And you can all nod your heads, you can all get irritated with me for bringing it up, but I'm sorry, you've got to accept that you're making a presumption that we all know everything is wrong as it should be. You can tell I'm annoyed.
Yeah, sorry, Chair, I think for you, just in terms of process, so I think obviously that extra clarification is helpful. Just to confirm, we've got a note here of the meeting, captured by Community Services Support and colleagues. That's there just to capture a board record of what was discussed. I think I understood Councillor Musgrave's point, and we have got that issue, and we'll make sure that we factor that in. I guess the point here, Chair, is to just, if it's helpful, make sure that the comments made tonight are recorded and add extra context to the minute that we've got here. And obviously, if there are any other changes or additions to the written note of the meeting, we'd obviously welcome them here now.
Can I come back on that, please? I like phrases like factor it in. What does that mean? How do you factor in something like that?
Through you, Chair, so we had, I gave just one example, we had a number of aspects of feedback, and I think at the heart of this is about the evaluation process is looking at that highest strategic level, And what we need to do is we need to work through and provide some advice, guidance and examples for members as to how specific local issues in particular services or in particular geographical areas, you know, how those issues can then be translated into the strategic criteria. So, for example, one of the things we briefly touched on tonight was the idea that if we happen to have a local issue and members evidencing that we've had a problem around collection of income on golf courses, for example, that does translate into the strategic objectives around things like financing, income recovery and things like that. So, you know, we need to make sure we do that. I think the plan would be that when we get together the next kind of session, we spend some time with members actually just providing some assistance that way around how local examples and issues with particular services translate into this evaluation process. And we've got that as a message as officers.
Thanks. I've got Mike Sullivan and then Steve Fox. I don't want to labour this too much. The point of me bringing it up was that we need better attendance. This is clearly, you know, an important thing that will affect everybody and everybody's board. So I expected more attendance than five people. And that's why I wanted to bring it quite high up on the agenda. I wanted to highlight I think the poor show that we had, but, you know, was that it was very poor.
Ian had no friends.
I'm used to
that. So,
I just said his own group. That's not true, is it? I'll just wait
for Ian to finish, Chair. And then I'm going to be very brief. Just a point of clarity for Mark, from Mark, I hope. The leisure services review, Mark, that's been very widespread on the parks and the libraries, and it was felt that it was going to Cabinet in October, but it was amongst other items that were going to Cabinet, and it was felt that this was such a huge decision and a big review that's being undertaken, that it's purely the Cabinet meeting in November is just one item on it. And I'm looking for clarity here, Mark. And have you got any date for that meeting, the Cabinet meeting in March? So I'd like clarity that it is just one item on the Cabinet agenda for that meeting. And any date that we've got in mind, Mark. Thank you. Thanks, Chair.
Okay.
Thank you, Chair. Thank you for that. So the question is welcome. So when the plan was to take the full business case report to Cabinet, whether that be October or November or that date, the plan was based on the importance of that full business case decision. There had been a debate about the size of the Cabinet agenda, and either on that meeting or on an alternative date, is there a one issue item to really give members of the Cabinet, etc., and the prominence of that particular item when that took place. The simple answer is that the report to November Cabinet is to the scheduled November Cabinet date. It will be one of a whole series of number of items in the normal way, and it's purely because it's not a full business case decision, it is just providing an update on the project. So there won't be any significant full business case decision at that time.
Thank you. Thanks, Chair.
Steve?
Yeah. Just to pass on your own remarks, Chair, it was fairly disappointing, but we did get something out of the meeting, so no meetings ever complete waste of members' time, but it is a matter of, you know, great importance and engagement by all members is something that should be appreciated. Just carrying on from Christina's point, because one of the beauties of deputising is that you see some of the other scrutiny committees, our business scrutiny committee, where we debated the whole commercialisation package for the council. And I would think one of the underpinning lines for commercialisation is that if you're not collecting income that you're entitled to now, you should look at that first and foremost. So things like golf courses where people are bumping on or where we're missing income, surely that should underpin the commercialisation programme so we get at least what we're entitled to now without thinking of other charges, extra charges or new ways of charging. So I would hope that some of these comments can transfer over to the people on the commercialisation agenda. There are gaps in our pension system where we're not getting money we're entitled to. So I'll just make that comment to transfer over. And I know Mike has chaired that committee here, hoping to take Christina's point on that if we're not collecting the money we're owed, then we shouldn't be talking about new charges.
Thank you, Steve. So can I just ask members if we can agree to note the report of the council from the original members to please attend the next week's session.
And we're all noting that we should be attending the next session.
Okay, thank you. So we now move on to the notice of motion, pavilions and sports grounds. That's going to be introduced by the board, Councillor Berry.
Thank you, Chair. First of all, I'll explain what the motion is seeking to achieve. I don't think it's controversial in any way. So basically, the motion is, Council notes that among the 2020 pledges is a commitment to ensure leisure and cultural opportunities for all. Council is therefore concerned with the poor condition of many of the sports pavilions and changing rooms within our parks, sports grounds, and open spaces. Council requests that a review of provisions undertaken by the Environment Scrutiny Committee, including visits to sites and evidence from sports clubs, football teams and other users, to enable a full assessment of the condition to take place and to explore opportunities for attracting external funding for refurbishment and repair. If I may, Chair, I'll trace out a little more detail to give an idea of the extent of the problem. I first became aware of the appalling conditions of some of our pavilions last year when I had an opportunity to look inside of one pavilion in Lynwood Park Mall. I was shocked to see the conditions that our young sports people are having to contend with. No heating in the middle of winter, showers and toilets that don't work. And when I spoke to the keyholder of the facility, he informed me that this was by no means an isolated case, and that many of the buildings which are used by bowls, clubs, footballers and tennis players have been neglected and exposed to vandalism and damage. I find it even more alarming that one of the Council pledges for 2020 is a promise to make sure everyone has access to leisure activities and that buildings will be fit for purpose. Wirralburra Council is clearly failing on both of these commitments. If we want to encourage more use of our playing fields and get more people into sport, then this needs to change. The buildings are often cold and damp, some don't have any heating or working showers, yet we're expecting clubs and their players to pay rent for these buildings. After an article in the Wirral Globe by Councillor Paul Hayes 7 months ago about this very issue, Councillor Hayes was contacted by the Association Director for Wirral Schools, and I'll just reiterate that it is the Director for Wirral. And these were some of his comments. I write to you with interest regarding your recent article in the Wirral Globe over the lack of or outdated sports facilities on the Wirral. I could not agree with you more strongly on this point. Our under-15s are due to play in the prestigious English Schools FA National Trophy semi-final on Saturday the 18th of March. It is our game to host as the home club. We are playing this game at Airbus FC in Wales. The reason being is that the investments into facilities for football and Wirral are, in my opinion, at an all-time low. From both council and private point of view. Additionally, we also train one session per week, but due to a number of factors, these sessions take place at Ellsbury Court Sports Coach in Cheshire. I honestly could go on for hours about the reasons why we play and train outside of the district, but your article answers many of them. The Wirral is underfunded, but more importantly, in my opinion, lacks leadership in regards to improvements of such facilities. I'm not claiming to think the problems will be solved just by throwing money at it, but it's clear we have very little leadership or plans in place to improve things. I wait with interest. suggest, Chair, it's time we had a look at some of these buildings, met with the clubs and players, and using them, and using the fees they pay, look at what improvements can be made. Thank you, Chair.
Chair, I'd just like to declare an interest in the fact that my grandson plays for Schoolboys and the statement is true.
Do we have a second? Thank you. Matt Sullivan.
Chair, I smiled at the beginning of the motion, which, because it reminded me of when I played football over in Liverpool in the 1950s and the early 1960s, about going into changing rooms with no showers and, in fact, no running water. And I think it is something that we should look at as a council. And we're talking about commercial. I'm sorry to interrupt, Chair.
I'll just get some advice.
Okay. I think we're looking at commercialisation, and the committee I chair are looking into it. Surely we should be looking at local businesses sponsoring our changing rooms so we can put boards up. And I watched in Pensby on Saturday, I watched a local game in the afternoon. And the changing rooms in Ridgewood Park, you know, I don't even know if there's any showers in there. It's dark, it's damp, it's dank. And I think we should be looking at, and it is a good notice of motion, I think, to highlight what our local teams, and when I hear that they have to go to Wales for a prestigious game, and the training, not in Will, it's really disappointing, but we should be looking at the commercialisation channel. Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Steve? Yeah, I don't think anybody who's been around the world as long as I have an amateur footballer of some disrepute playing on all those grounds. And yet the situation for a period of time was some investment, and then it seemed to come back. I'd like to sort of bring attention to the committee of the route in which we discuss matters and the way things happen. This was, as a case in point, it was a notice of motion to full council. However, we've just referred to a meeting about that very subject, a whole range of leisure facilities where virtually nobody attended, nobody was there to raise that point. Maybe the next one they can come along and raise that issue, but in general, because it will need significant funding, and one of the delivery ways of looking for delivery models is how we get that funding and what we prioritise within that funding, and that would be one of the outcomes of that. So it is one of the unusual that a notice of motion is the trigger for this. However, the notice of motion is before us. Secondly, later on in the report, we will be looking at this committee's work programme. And, you know, of something that suddenly, you know, that is of such importance, nobody's bothered attending from, that I can see, or put forward in the Conservative group or anyone else, that this be a particular specific item. My view is that if we're looking at leisure, culture, and all of the branches of leisure services, parks, buildings, everything, that it dovetails perfectly into the overall review. And if we begin to say, well, we'll pick X or Y or Z, then we were not looking at the situation in the round. So my view would be that this notice of motion is well-meaning, I hope it's well-meaning, and it is a trigger for us to maybe look at that as part of the delivery model for leisure and get some investment into that area. So my view is that there is a vehicle for that to happen. Pity that it didn't get directly into the work programme. I will give one view though that might allow us, which was my suggestion some time ago, about the mystery shopping exercises that elected members can engage in. And I'm not jumping ahead, Chair, but the work programme does give an opportunity perhaps for one member or a couple of members to go around and physically look at some of our facilities or actually try and book a course at the tennis courts or what, whatever it is, and actually just report back just as part of an umbrella way program. So I think there's plenty of vehicles there for it, and I'd be minded to hope that we are having this debate sort of triggered, that as part of the overall view of leisure and culture, that we get to the point where these services are seen as a Cinderella service and all services can be run back equally. So I would, in true helpfulness to notice the motion, rather than simply saying yes, so what, it's actually an appeal for that to be part of the overall view of leisure and culture services in round. If that finds favour, it's a fair thing to go ahead.
I think the final paragraph does suggest that this committee does take a review of the popular work programme. I mean, I do understand when people sometimes go to full council and it's led by a member who's not part of this committee, and also there's always a lag between council and the new committees, you know, this full council in particular. I think it was well from July or something. So there is always a lag, and perhaps that's when it came up and there wasn't going to be a committee next, so that they went down that route. So that, I don't know.
That's absolute nonsense, Chair. Adam Sykes is the spokesperson for this committee, I still believe. And you called a meeting, a specific meeting, to discuss what would be in the work programme for the forthcoming year. And no Conservative members attended. This disengagement by the Conservatives is absolutely a disgrace. Now, they might have to use the Council's notice of motion because it gets possibly to the world headline. But actually, if scrutiny needs to mean anything, it means to be engaging with scrutiny, particularly the spokesperson, to engage in it in that way. And we have got an ongoing pleasure review. My view would be that, you know, that would be the vehicle for it. But to say it's about time and all that, it's an absolute nonsense now, because you're not engaging with the chair.
Thanks for Steve's interruption. He picks his own rules on everything. I think he still thinks he's the leader of the council. So anyway, my point was, how it came here doesn't matter. I think Steve's trying to make political points and score points on other processes and so on. The point is, everyone actually probably in this room agrees with this. All we're asking is, can it go on to the work programme? If everyone in this room can agree, as he did point out, the intention of it is well known. It's just to point out an issue and hopefully we can make some progress on it. Whether we agree on the process of how we got here or what we're going to do afterwards, leave that to him.
I've got Christina and Tony Smith.
When I raised the issue of my one example, which apparently is parochial, but my one example is a Millman, I was told. I was told that we that it was going to be. Shall we wait for you to finish, Mark? Before we carry on.
Sorry, I'm just taking some advice.
Right, okay. Mark said, I can't remember the phrase, but it is asking what it meant, which basically said meant that when we find these things where we are losing money, so clearly we've lost money because they've gone, that football team and everything associated with it has moved. Here we have my example of people not being asked for the money at the golf course. Surely, rather than have it as a work programme, we need to make sure that all this information goes to Mark. But I don't think we can do it in the work programme because it's part of the ongoing review. And that's where I think it's got difficult, because we're in the middle of this review. And as I said, in my old person's way, which clearly nobody understood, except probably one or two, if we're making assumptions about what we're looking at, we could all go, oh yeah, we've got pavilions and we've got sports teams and they did this, that and the other. Until we'd read in the paper about what happened to them, we wouldn't have known. So I think that somehow we've got to translate that information to Mark so that they are aware that we would make more money on things if perhaps places were clean. I can cite many examples in the swimming world. It's not just football. So I think it's there. But how we get that information to Mark and how it goes from anecdotal to truth, I don't know. Or what do they class as anecdotal? I do think we've got a slight problem here, Chair, because of the ongoing review. And I would say it's got to be covered in the review and not in the work programme. So I couldn't agree with you on the work programme. But that information has to be got to Mark, please ask us for it.
Okay, thanks, Chair. Just sort of following up what Anita said, I mean, I go down to London on a regular basis, and my two grandchildren, grandsons, play football down there, and on the pitches on Saturdays and Sundays. There seems to be greater coordination with officers of those local authorities and the clubs down there, and the facilities are quite excellent, really. And following up on what Mike said, there's big sponsorship there all the time. They're actually, the youngsters don't have to pay any money at all to actually play there. The sponsor, the trophies, the shirts, everything. It's the coordination. I've spoken to the managers of these clubs, youngsters down there, and they were saying, well, we talk with the local authority, but it's Wandsworth or Lambeth or whatever, and they're having this. Now, I think that's lacking here. You know, we should know about the lack of facilities for youngsters and that. So, you know, it should be not something that we need to spend a long time looking at. Let's see how we can move in very quickly. We're talking about having healthy environments for children and that. And Christina is right, you know, it's not just football, it's also the golf. I mean, this is what I've been bringing up in Cabinet for the last 3 years about golf, both at Arrow Park and the others, because I play there on a regular basis. And most people don't pay. They really do not pay. You know, they start out, and I've reported this endlessly to people. And sometimes something happens for about 6 weeks, and you see, and then it drifts back again. I think we're losing a lot of money. I just do not think, you know, we're proactive in these particular areas. We've got to, we should have greater coordination with the clubs, with the leisure facilities that we have. We've got fantastic leisure facilities here, but we're not making the best use of them.
Absolutely.
Thank
you, Tony. I've got Chris and then Kia.
Just want to make a couple of quick points. Steve's sort of thing about councils going out and being sort of mystery shoppers and trying stuff is a bit bizarre, I think. And I can't get my head around this idea that we've got a golf course where people are just playing golf and the money's not being collected. Is that down to, you imagine we're going to get into this commercial sort of thing. I come from a commercial background. If it was my golf course that wasn't being paid for, those people would be sacked. My question is it accountability that we're lacking downstream? Because we seem to have it at the head of the table. We've got these wonderful conversations about we need to be better attuned and all the rest of it. But the other end is there, or the people are supposed to be there collecting money, nothing's happening.
Look, there aren't people collecting money, that's
the question. Sorry, I have to interrupt.
Sure.
This is about Dr. Dillon as well, Trent, for some reason, and taking it off and back on to it.
I'm just answering a couple of questions that have been put forward, so. I find it bizarre that we're even arguing about it at the moment.
Ian.
I'd like to talk about sports brilliance.
Yes, please.
Closing name. What I think the motivation behind this was not just well meaning, I think it was a case of urgent, really, because if we have got young people who are either being discouraged from playing football because they can't get to Wales in North Wales, or they're having to be ferried out to Wales in North Wales, for example. That is not only bad because we're losing money, it's also bad because we've got facilities here that we are not aware of in the case of the condition that they're in. I accept Steve's point, you know, but by all means, I think any member of this council, whatever party, is perfectly entitled to raise an issue to a notice of motion. That is enshrined in the constitution of this council. You might not like it, but that's the way it is. And these notices of motion, the two that we have before us tonight, are perfectly valid, and that they've been referred by the Mayor, rightly or wrongly, to this committee, and we are being asked to debate them. Either the request for a review of the provision, it's not in conflict to the review of leisure services, it would complement the review of leisure services, because at some point, when Mark, as he outlined in the previous article, when we get the report saying this is, you know, this is the business case, this is what's proposed next, I think as a committee it would be quite useful to understand what it is that we're looking at transferring, the condition of that building stock, and what it's going to cost to repair and refurbish some of this, whether it's asset transfer or through grants or however we try and do that. So I don't see this as being in conflict to that report that Steve's mentioned. I think this would be quite useful, and certainly to give the opportunity to some of the sports clubs in this borough to have a say and to feel that their views are being listened to as part of that process. If it's the mechanism of a task and finish group that we go out there and look at some of these sports clubs, Councillor Fowler said the business committee, I recall half your members got up and walked out before the end of the meeting, so you don't try that one, you share my.
I did correct
you. Thanks, sir.
Please be tear up.
If I can just comment that this seems to be more of a service specific issue, and I just wonder whether members would be more comfortable in us asking officers to go away and look into this and bring back a report into the conditions of these services, rather than start a task and finish which can be longer and delayed. And Mark, do you want to comment on that suggestion?
Through you, Chair, I think there are a number of ways of progressing this. I think Councillor Hurst makes a point about, you know, is there an element of urgency here? Now, clearly, we have got a major transformation project ongoing that will absolutely get to grips with a whole series of these issues, and it's doing that. Interestingly, one of the significant bodies of work that we've done is around looking at our playing pitches and our playing pitch strategy, and that's one of a number of things that is feeding into the bigger transformation project. I guess there is a question about timing. So obviously, you know, that transformation project, as we've talked about already, you know, is obviously just going to be on a slack more extended timeline now. So if members, I'd suggest the question is around, you know, is there an urgency to look at this? And is it seen as sufficient prominence and important to actually, you know, to bring your report into the work plan? If both of those questions were a yes in the view of the committee, then certainly as a starting point, a good way forward would be to ask for, you know, a report from the officers directly involved in managing the service to come back and actually to talk about the detail and actually give a perspective from them, which obviously we've not got at the moment, and I haven't got that insight into, but I'm sure that, you know, the manager of the service would have a view and comments on some comments on this. Thank you.
So would members be in agreement with that?
Yeah, first of all, yeah.
As we're at some point, we're then going to be asked this question from doing the percentages. I'd actually rather see for myself, rather than that. Yes, a report would be really good, but I'd actually like to see for myself now, because this has raised all sorts of queries in my mind. And whilst I know you were only talking about pavilions, we've given examples, it looks like we're all saying the same thing. We feel that we're not making the best use of what we've got. So I really want to go and see, because in my head, changing rooms for football, never had heating, and you'd be a softy if you had heating. That's just in my head, because I don't play football. That's what I would. I'd rather than yet another report, I'd like the report, but I'd like to have something to hang it on.
Thanks, Chair. I just really wanted to elaborate on the point I made before about my grandson being selected for Rural Boys. When this actually took place, I did highlight to our asset management team about my disgust really that there wasn't the facilities on the Wirral, and this is going back 7 months now, but there wasn't the facilities on the Wirral for them to be able to play. They're attracting people from all over the country, which could generate, you know, people wanting to come and stay in the Wirral, for instance, might not know where the Wirral is. So, you know, there are, it's not just a case of we're not providing the facilities, it's bigger than that. The other thing that I wanted to say is pavilions in sports ground for some is a privilege, because in Leaside they haven't even got a toilet or a pavilion until we got some sponsorship through Tranmere Rovers, through Section 106, and that's now available to people in Leaside. But that's been like that as long as I've been a councillor, which is 6 years. I'm sure Ian could add to that for the years that he's there. There's never been any provision for toilets or changing whatsoever. So a pavilion, in some cases, could pass as a privilege.
Well, we haven't got any use in the football meetings.
Right, okay. Can I suggest a way forward, Chair, if it's possible?
Can someone?
Yeah, it'll be a lot. I mean, clearly, the ongoing review will be taking place. I see no reason why members can't raise this issue as part of that ongoing review. Data that are coming out soon. We have got within the WEAR programme scopes for mystery shopping, so if members are inclined to do some of that, then I'm sure it wouldn't be difficult for the officers to go and get access to the difficult just even on Sunday morning to barge in, as you might that you might not want to see. Going back to my football days, but certainly the case with any task and finish has always been an initial report to set the scene and then for members to dig that. So if that makes a bit of common sense that we continue with the ongoing leisure review, and this subject will be part of that inevitably, that we also receive future officers' reports on a specific issue, and if members do wish to go as a group to look at some of the facilities in between whatever timescale that is, that be permitted as well. But I think that does really fit.
Okay, seems like
Yeah. Just to add to that, I think that's a helpful proposal, Stephen. Thank you for that.
Yes.
I think in between getting the report, in between tonight's meeting, we'll just get the officer's report on this specific issue. I think it would be useful for those members of the volunteer to go out and maybe get the council to have organised, either just for planning side to us.
Yes.
You know, we could then nominate some pavilions we're aware of, or that the reporters and members are aware of, and that members will be able to see those. And you know, the principle of mystery shopping is you don't tell the person that you're coming. So it would have to be volunteers to play, Christina, but actually, it's nothing you haven't seen before.
That's another element.
But you know, we have that programme, and you know, so we can go out there and see for ourselves and come back to complement the report that we're getting from the officers.
Okay, thank you. And just one thing,
Patrick, it's all fine tonight. Sorry, just one moment. So, just the children, families, who screen that we've been starting to get a series of reality check visits, and there's their answers have answered what Councillor Oates has just said, and with the agreements of the officers. Very small groups of members to go out to the pavilions, you know, at various different times and look at the facilities to whether that's where events are going on. And rather than maybe a mystery shopper.
Okay, no. I just call it a mystery shopper because that's the term we use on the air to travel, so all the way there.
Could I ask why we have to look at the facilities when they're there? If they're not there, we can still see the facilities, we don't know what it's like.
Yeah, but you've got something
open it for us.
Yeah, can I, just as a point of clarity, Chair, please?
Right, then I'm going to vote.
For someone,
close.
Am I okay to speak, Chair?
Yes, Mike.
Thank you. Just for a point of clarity with Christina, the changing rooms when they play on a Saturday and a Sunday are opened, and then the people go in and get changed, of course. Yeah. But when they come out to go and play, there's a period of time before the changing room are unlocked